Dear students, today we are going to learn on gastrointestinal reflex. In that particularly we will learn about hypertrophic pyloric stenosis. So as the name suggests, stenosis is the narrowing of the pyloric sphincter. And hypertrophic means the circular muscles of this pylorus become enlarged, extended, and that presses on the pylorus, thus narrowing the lumen of the pyloric sphincter. So that is the condition we are going to learn. So this is one of the most common problem of the infancy. Okay, this is progressive overgrowth or enlargement of the circular muscles of pylorus causing partial or total obstruction of the stomach outlet due to the narrowing of the lumen, as I said. Also, I explain in diagram, you will understand better. We know that esophagus is connecting ending in the stomach. Okay, so this is the part of the stomach fundus body. The end part of the stomach is this pyloric stricture, okay, sphincter, pyloric sphincter. So the muscles of this, the pyloric muscles getting enlarged, thickened, and therefore you can see the outlet of the stomach is almost getting closed or narrow. So what will happen, whatever milk the baby will take, that remains in the stomach itself, that is not able to go into the intestine for digestion and absorption. So this is the condition. Now, in this condition, we will see the causes, etiology. So the main cause is unknown, and the contributing factors are when maternal stress is there, especially in the last trimester. Then, due to the elevated prostaglandin level in mother during pregnancy, also when there is deficiency of nitric acid, then when there is immature pyloric ganglion cells. So these are the causes due to which this occurs. Okay. Now we will see the pathophysiology. Already you understood in the diagram. Here what happens? The pyloric stricture or the sphincter getting narrowed because of the enlargement of the circular muscle. So the lumen of the stomach outlet becomes very narrow or almost getting closed. Now if this condition is there, what will happen? Whatever feed the baby takes, it does not go into the intestine for absorption. It just remains in the stomach. So there is fullness of the stomach. So in return, what baby will do? Baby will regurgitate and vomit out whatever food she or he has taken. So that's what happening in this disease condition. Now we will see the clinical features or clinical manifestation or sign and symptoms. So by now you must have understood that as the stomach remains full, that is regurgitation, that is projectile, non-bilious vomiting. Projectile is without nausea, the baby vomits out all of sudden. That is constant hunger, because whatever feed baby takes, it is vomited out. It does not get absorbed in the small and large intestine. Then baby is irritable, failure to thrive. Failure to thrive means the growth and development is very poor. Loss of weight because baby is not getting any nutrition. There is also decreased quantity of the stool and urine output. It is reduced. Baby is lethargic, weak. Sometimes baby will present with the diarrhea with the greenish stool. Also there is dehydration and epigastric fullness because the stomach remains full always. Okay, now we see the diagnosis. How we can diagnose this baby? So we can take the history, also the clinical examination. If we do the clinical examination, you will find the pyloric mass. The pyloric is having some mass, you can feel there. Also you can go for the clean x-ray of abdomen. It will show that the lumen of the outlet of the stomach is narrowed or almost closed down. Also, we can go for the barium bill x-ray. We can go for the sonography or blood examination and urine examination. So, these were the diagnostic tests that we can do. Now, we will see the management. How we can manage this case. So, the medicine will not help at all. So, there is no medical management for this condition. The surgical management is the choice. So, Ramstedt's pyelonephritis is done at the age of 4 to 5 weeks. So, here what they do, the circular muscles that is distended, enlarged, that is removed through the surgery, and the way is made for the feed to go into the small intestine. So, this surgery is called pyelonephritis. Okay. Now we see the nursing management. Like any other condition, we have to go for the pre and post operative management. In pre operative management, we have to maintain fluid electrolyte balance of the child, maintain nutritional status, then reassure the parents because they are in anxiety, worry, provide routine pre operative care, also put the nasogastric tube to aspirate the stomach content to reduce the vomiting. Put the baby in upright position so that the vomiting is reduced. Then provide small and frequent feed to the baby. Prevent infection by hand washing practices. Then continuously monitor the condition of the baby, check vital signs, hydration status, etc. Then involve the parents in the child care. Okay. Now we see the post-operative management. In post-operative management, small liquid feed is allowed after 8 to 12 hours of the surgery. So that expressed breast milk is given to the baby. Then keep the baby's head elevated at 45 to 60 degree angle so that the vomiting is reduced. Then provide routine post-operative care like warmth, feeding, wound care, medication, hygiene care, and so on. Also provide the support to the parents. Involve parents in the child's care. Teach them home care, follow-up care, etc. Okay, now we see the complication. The complication that can arise is fluid electrolyte imbalance, persistent obstruction can be there, duodenal perforation can arise, hematemesis can occur, jaundice, tetany. Now we see the nursing diagnosis. So, fluid volume deficit can arise, imbalance nutrition related to vomiting, discomfort and pain related to surgery, parental anxiety related to the child's illness, risk for injury, and impaired skin integrity. So that's it all about the